So Andy and I both believe that one can separate technical and musical studies from one another. One absolutely feeds the other. We need technique to express our musical ideas, and we also need musical ideas to create a piece of art when we are performing. We need musical ideas to put emotions into our playing in order to communicate with the audience, and not only with the audience, but also with our fellow musicians. So today's talk will not just be on achieving a good tone and fast technique, but also on some necessary work that we have to do on us, ourselves, in order to become an artist. And Sigurd Rascher stresses this in his preface to Scales for the Saxophone, the very good scale book. We will be talking about that later too. And he talks about why critical thinking is important for any musician. And therefore, I'd like to start today with a quote from that book. "The ability to play an instrument is not inherited. It can neither be donated, nor can it be bought. It must be acquired. This is done in a healthy situation through the free will of the player. That is, choice, aim, and decision are essential in the quest for ability and knowledge. The acquisition of ability is often degraded to a repetition of bodily actions. This is drill, the proper method to train animals. Between information and drill lies learning, possible only for humans. When I learn a piece, I grasp its essence mentally. I form an inner counterpart for it. This acquired understanding then directs bodily actions necessary to recreate the piece. An activity is satisfying for mankind only if its meaning and purpose are understood. This is learning. Its results stay with me. It changes me. Constant repetition while practicing is an absolute waste of time. Instead, what we need to do is we need to challenge our mind to think while practicing. When we change things up, that results in increased brain activity, and therefore we will learn much faster, needing less practice time. One thing that also often gets totally left by the wayside is mental practice. And there are several different ways of mental practice, but it's like such an important way to get a deeper understanding of the music. Somebody once stated that the life of a musician is actually as hard on the body as that of a professional athlete. And so that's why it's important to look out for our own health.
I think the saxophone exacerbates issues of that we have in everyday life. So if you speak to people that do body work in its various forms, they often talk about, you know, as we're at our computers, this forward inward rotation. So you've all got, a lot of you have a laptop in front of you right now. If you lean in, you know, the shoulders come in, back goes forward, and it's life kind of takes us that direction. And of course, then you do sometimes see older people for whom that's stuck, you know? And so if we have a saxophone, it's the same thing. You're there and this is coming in, this is coming in. And of course, then you've also got the weight around your neck pulling you down and forward. So down and forward are these kind of, I suppose, attrition factors in day-to-day life, particularly modern life. And so we need to counter that in some way.
So it's absolutely essential to stand up straight. So straight back, shoulders relaxed, and then stretching from here. Then what I like to do, I like to lift from here a little bit, because when I lift from here, you can feel actually how your shoulders go back. We all have seen saxophonists with their chicken arms, right? It always keeps going like this, or it keeps going like this. It's actually very bad for the muscle that runs here on your neck. This muscle actually connects to your first rib, and the first rib sits down in there. And when you tense this muscle, it actually pulls up your first rib. And when you pull up your first rib, then you can imagine, you know, like then your entire body gets out of alignment. That's when other muscles are tightening and start to have pain. So what I like to do with my arms, ever so slightly, I like to move them out. You move them out, actually your shoulders come down, and actually you also give your lungs room to breathe a little bit.
The other thing to point out is touring. I mean, I've had the same experience when I've had really bad issues. It's been when I've been schlepping cases around on, you know, all sorts of planes or trains or whatever. And it's amazing, again, as we said, you're resilient to that up to a point, and when it hits you, it really causes a problem. The worst thing I've had is also that same muscle, I think it's the trapezius, and it comes up the neck and back down around the shoulder blade. That's where, for me, is a watch point. And I think that's one that really is potentially problematic. But I think it's pretty consistent. It's forward, down, and twist that we need to counteract.
So your feet, Andy, how do you place your feet when you're standing?
I think if you're kind of solid and shoulder width apart and kind of can feel yourself, feel your weight into the floor, then you're in good shape.
I feel like if one has problems with that and you notice that you're dancing a lot or that you're not feeling secure, for example, on stage, it helps to think about that shoulder width apart or the left foot slightly forward. One thing that I learned from yoga is this position where you put 60% of your body weight on the front of the foot. And it somehow makes me feel very grounded because you're not back. You are actually like in a stance where you're like, you're prepared to run or you're prepared to fight or you're prepared to play a concert. So why does the body affect the tone, Andy?
Well, I think it's like anything. If we're crushed up, particularly here with the neck is crushed and strained forward. You know, we're trying to create space and we're trying to have control of how the air is flowing through. And so any of these things are going to cause all sorts of issues. If you are restricting your airflow, or you're restricting the way you can move the air, you're restricting where you can voice in the back in that kind of glottal position. All of these things will tend to bring tension and diminishment to your sound. And so it really does take away from any of the good work you're doing elsewhere.
Your body shape and size affects reverberation. And that affects which overtones are favorite in your tone. And so that affects how you sound. So if you have a crappy sound day, it might as well that you are very tense, for example. You're gonna sound different if you have a tense day. So when we think about that, you know, like how everything that we do with our body affects our playing, the question is, why don't we do something for that? Why don't we do something that helps our body stay healthy and helps us play the best? Because we can't just work on our fingers. Cardio exercises, for example, they help with endurance. You not only need like physical endurance, but also mental endurance. I think, Andy, you've been doing a lot of Alexander technique, right?
Yeah, so I studied Alexander technique for a number of years, and a number of you will have heard of it, but for those that maybe just want a summary, it's essentially a technique or a method of retraining the perception of body use and identifying areas in which we don't use the physicality well or efficiently or healthily, and training the mind to essentially correct that. There's a sense in which I maybe need something that's a bit more physical and that deals with more kind of stretch and strengthening to actually really sort of strengthen the bits of my body I know I need to kind of realign. And so I would caveat a sort of sense of the technique with saying, actually, I'm now looking at maybe yoga or Pilates or something like that to sort of give a more holistic take on it. But it's definitely worth investigating.
Sigurd Rasha wrote an article, it's called Inner Pollution. And he questioned in that article why so many people worry about protecting their hands from danger when they read cheap novels or watch the most violent movies. He goes a step further. All my examples were bodily examples. He is going to the step where you know, like all these things affect your mind and you need your mind to play saxophone. And so why not spend your time with activities that challenge your mind?